Hi, everyone, and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Kelsey Kamen, and I am the program coordinator for NCWIT's Counselors for Computing. It's my pleasure to bring you the second episode of this six-part series. It's hosted by NCWIT Counselors for Computing. Each month through July, we will be connecting you with thought leaders at the cutting edge of technology. This series offers a unique opportunity to dive into the intersection of computer science with traditional and non-traditional STEM fields. We refer to that here as CS plus X. We would ask you to submit your questions through the Q&A feature at the bottom of your toolbar. That should be right at the bottom of your screen, and you can ask questions all throughout the presentation. We may answer them live, or we may answer them right within the Q&A feature. Tell you a little bit about the National Center of Women in Information Technology. It is a nonprofit community of more than 1,400 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. NCWIT equips change leaders with resources for taking action in recruiting, retaining, and advancing women across the entire computing ecosystem. Before NCWIT, programs focusing on women in computing existed mostly in isolation, without the benefit of shared practices, effective resources, communication with others, or national reach. So today, these programs are part of the NCWIT community, creating a far greater impact than if institutions acted alone. Counselors for Computing is one of those programs in the NCWIT K-12 Alliance. The NCWIT Counselors for Computing program, or C4C, provides information and resources that help counselors join the front line of the computing conversation. We bring people and programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to transformative computing careers. We wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM, the largest employer of scientists and engineers in the nation. DoD STEM offers educational programs, internships, and scholarships for students and many career development opportunities for educators. We will be sharing their website in the chat for you to learn more. First, I would like to introduce Johnny Fernandez, director of NCWIT's K-12 Alliance and Tecnologicas, an initiative of NCWIT. Thank you, Johnny.
Thank you, Kelsey. Hello, everyone, and good afternoon. As Kelsey mentioned, my name is Johnny Fernandez, and I direct the K-12 Alliance and Tecnologicas program, which I'm here to talk to you about for a few minutes. So Tecnologicas was an initiative that NCWIT and the Televisa Foundation launched as a media campaign back in 2015 to bring information, inspiration, and resources to Latino households about the opportunities that come from pursuing careers in technology. We continue to do this today through our media presence, whether it's on social media and also through public service announcements that air on Univision stations throughout the country, reaching millions of Hispanic households, helping to normalize the computing field in Latino households. So we have over 550 Tecnologicas ambassadors, role models, Latinas in STEM, thriving in various fields of STEM, who provide information, again, inspiration, and most importantly, the outreach aspect of this program is where right now, virtually, we meet with students and with families in the communities to bring information about different careers in computer science, leading activities, which are often times the first exposure that some of these students get to computing or computing fields. So we're hosting all of these events right now virtually, but one of the things that I would encourage all of you who are here today would be definitely to also tap into our collection of videos. These role models on our YouTube channel, we have over 100 videos, both in English and Spanish, featuring these Latina role models that are speaking to educators, that are speaking to parents and adult influencers, and are also speaking to the students to really get them excited and motivated to pursue in their footsteps and really succeed as the future creators of technology. If you want to skip to the next slide. So some of the ways, again, in which you can either get engaged or support the campaign, watch and share our videos, follow us on social media, share our campaign, share our inspirational posts on all of our social media platforms. If you or anybody that you know is a Latina in STEM and would like to become a Tecnologicas ambassador, so you can go to our website, tecnologicas.org, and click on the sign up button, create a profile, and help us spread the word and this passion for technology in Latino communities. And then also, if you're interested in having a Tecnologica come virtually to your school, just reach out, send an email to tecnologicas@ncwed.org, and we can make that happen for you. We just really love to engage with our educators, with our counselors, knowing that providing these role models to the students is a really powerful way to not just bring them the information, but for the girls to see themselves as the future creators of technology. I know that that was kind of quick, and you may have questions. Please feel free to add them on the chat. I'll be here also to answer any more questions you may have later on. So that's Tecnologicas. Thank you for the opportunity to talk to every single one of you.
Johnny, thank you so much for sharing these and about the program. I can't echo enough how powerful it is to have role models that look like us in careers that that we aspire to have. So thank you.
Certainly, my pleasure.
I would now like to introduce Carissa Lintao. Hi, Carissa.
Hello, hello, Kelsey. Hello, everyone.
Carissa is a kind innovator. I really like that. And the CEO and founder of Apptuitive, an award-winning app store optimization agency. She's been recognized in Forbes, CNBC, Business Insider, and Roadtrip Nation's documentary Venture Forward for her entrepreneurial efforts and focus on changing tech for the better. Chris's passion is raising awareness about the intersection of ethics and tech to bridge information gaps and level the playing field. So Carissa has pre-recorded her presentation today, and now I would like to present what makes an app addicting. Again, please feel free to share questions in the Q&A feature throughout the presentation.
Hey everyone, my name is Carissa Lintao. I'm the CEO and founder of Apptuitive, an award-winning app marketing agency. We specialize in app store optimization, and basically what that means is app marketing. But on the side, I run workshops independently and with organizations like Tecnologicas and C4C. In this workshop, I'm super pumped to start teaching you guys about what makes an app, quote unquote, addicting. So I'm sure you've all said it at one point. I'm addicted to my phone. I can't stop using this app. I don't know why I can't put it down. But it's important that you know that that is for very good reason. Developers actually kind of design against humans half of the time. So, you know, the main goal that developers want is for you to spend as much time in the app as humanly possible. But the first thing I want to do is I want to clarify the differences between addiction versus habit, because odds are you are definitely not addicted to your phone. The people who are addicted to their phones are a very small subset of the population. It's a very like 1%, meaning they cannot put their phone down and they cannot get through life without using it. That's kind of the main differences between addiction versus habit. The World Health Organization actually classifies addiction as an actual hard dependence on a substance, such as drugs or alcohol and very harmful substances like that. Whereas, you know, a habit is actually something that you do often and regularly. So a good habit might be doing chores, you know, doing the laundry on a bi-weekly or a weekly basis, praying, whatever may have you. But this is something that you do often and regularly, sometimes without knowing that you're doing it in the first place. An example of this, you know, going back to the technology example, is constantly checking your phone, even though in the first place, it's just a force of habit at that point. So those are the main differences between addiction and habits. And going forward, it's just really important to shop, and even moving forward, is that apps aren't just apps. They're businesses specifically designed for you to make certain actions and investments in the app, whether or not it's in your best interest or not. Here are a few examples of just how much money these, you know, mega apps on your phone that everyone uses rake in a year. I think these figures were taken back in 2019. So for example, Instagram made a whopping $1.6 billion, and Facebook, kind of the whole Goliath in this space, a social network that everyone uses, made $17 billion in 1 year. And kind of the main way that these apps make money is advertisements. So, you know, the more ads you're consuming, the more money goes straight into their pocket. And, you know, take, for example, Facebook newsfeed. There's so many ads. If you look at it on, there's this side column with a ton of small ads, and you have your bigger ads, video ads, that people pay even more money to get straight in front of your face because it is integrated directly with your friends and family's posts. And you have even ads on the left-hand side of the Facebook homepage. And again, it's important to know that if you're not paying directly for the product, which really 99% of apps you don't pay for in a very straightforward way, you're the product. So there are so many different ways that, you know, app developers can kind of monetize, you know, you as a person, but it ultimately comes down to how much attention you're giving the app in the first place. So it comes down to time spent in the app. So now we're going to jump straight into the hooked model. I absolutely love talking about this. And again, it's just really great information to know just in your day-to-day life. So you're more cognizant as to, you know, why you're spending so much time in your phone, and, you know, you can see red flags and kind of put a stop to, you know, a bad habit more or less. So the first thing we're going to jump into is the triggers, which is kind of the whole kickstart of the hooked model. So it goes trigger, action, reward or variable reward, and investment. And this is a never-ending constant loop that every developer, no matter how big or small, really tries to implement and integrate in their app to keep you coming back and tapping for more. So what are triggers? Every single habit-forming app starts with an external trigger. And what is an external trigger, you may ask? Well, the most prominent one is a push notification. And if you have your push notifications turned on, I feel like this might automatically click, because whenever you see a push notification, your brain is, as humans too, it's automatically hardwired to kind of tap into it and see what new thing you're gonna get into by tapping into that notification. A friend could have tagged you in a new photo, you could have gotten a new like on, you know, an Instagram post. That's kind of the most prominent trigger that really kickstarts a bad quote-unquote phone habit. A lot of the time that these external triggers pop up, they're really tied to an internal trigger that you're feeling. So for example, making a new Spotify playlist, they'll prompt different notifications at different times based on the type of playlist you made. But this is kind of a separate example. But for example, an internal trigger might be, you know, if you're feeling sad, you might go to Spotify and to make a new sad playlist and kind of, you know, to kind of sit and feel that feeling at that moment. Another example of an internal trigger might be, you know, you're feeling, to use a sad example again, you're feeling sad, and a way you kind of vent and an outlet that you look for is shopping. So Amazon might shoot you, you know, a notification. It might not be at the same time, but if they do it on a continual basis of sending you push notifications, odds are Amazon is going to be one of the first things that you open up when, you know, you're feeling sad or you feel like you need something, even though you might not necessarily need that thing in the first place. Examples of triggers in action. Again, kind of the most prominent ones are push notifications, but it's really also cool to know that a lot of triggers are really highlighted in red. Psychology behind that. You see it in a ton of advertising and fast food places along the highway to kind of like grab your attention. That's kind of the feelings that the color red focuses on. It grabs your attention really fast, and it indicates that you need to do something right away. So, you know, you have buy now, or, you know, if you're an avid Netflix binge watcher, it'll show you that the next episode is starting in literally a few seconds right after, which is, you know, a funny thing to see because it doesn't even give you time to breathe. Essentially, with Netflix, it'll automatically start playing the next video. And again, you know, you look at your Instagram or social media notifications that come through when someone likes your photo. Those are almost all of the time red, without a doubt. So that's just super helpful to know moving forward. The second part of the hooked model is action. So this is kind of the main thing that app developers really are prompting you to do. So, you know, a few examples of actions are scrolling, searching for different profiles on Instagram, playing with an app, DMing a friend, or buying something off of Amazon. And odds are is that the app developers are really lining up your user experience to take these specific actions as easily and as seamlessly as possible. So again, the main goal here is that they want to get you through the hooked model as fast as possible, so it becomes more and more habitual. So here's a great kind of fun example of, you know, how many call to actions can you spot? I'll give you a hint. There's not just two. It looks like there's two right away, but those are the two main ones they want you to pay attention to, but there's 13, roughly 13 in total. So I'll give you time to pause the video and try to see how many you can get. Okay, perfect. If you couldn't find 13, I'll kind of go through them. Okay, so off the top of my head, here's the one. This is, you know, your DMs. This is kind of the main action, or, you know, sending photos to and from with your friends. There's IGTV. There's the camera. There's another IGTV logo. So here you tap into it to view the entire video as a whole. You have your saved icon, another DM'd icon, a comment icon, a like icon, and then all of these tools here at the bottom would be classified as a call to action as well. So really, app developers love to plug as many, as many things as you can do to take an app, keep you in it for, again, as long as humanly possible. And now here's kind of the next section that we already discussed with triggers and actions. So the main thing, if developers can pull this off right, you're kind of stuck in a never-ending constant loop of being in this app. So this is what we call a variable reward. What a variable reward is, studies done on this dating back to the 1950s, I believe, where they did a study with mice, and basically they would shoot out a ton of different, like, cheeses and chocolates, I believe, on a regular basis, and they found that the rats loved it, obviously. But once they started varying the schedules as to when they would receive a treat, they found that there was so much more anticipation for the thing, meaning that they were quote-unquote hooked. And they were just kept in such a state of anticipation that as soon as the piece of reward came out, they were there immediately. And this is kind of what notifications and especially social media apps use. You can also look at this for e-commerce as well. So, you know, an example of this would be Cyber Monday, not knowing which deals are coming out. The feeling can almost be the equivalent to the night before Christmas. When you were a kid, you know, you couldn't go to sleep. You had to figure out what was waiting for you underneath the tree. This is the same exact feeling that you'll get with a variable reward. So you can see here that this is kind of the brain while anticipation. Just, I mean, look at this compared to its normal state of activity. I threw this in an example because, you know, as soon as you post an Instagram post, you're just automatically waiting to see who's gonna like it, what are they gonna say, who are they gonna send it to. It's just a very heightened state of brain activity. And that's ultimately what your phone comes down to, the notification center. That's where app developers really try to pull you in. So I'll go into a little bit of the psychology of app design here. A lot of game design and social media design, the developers behind that specific design were actually a few of the early designers behind casino games and lottery games, as crazy as that may sound. So in this specific example, I'm going to use pulling a lever, right? So you're sitting down at a slot machine for hours because the game developers make it extremely easy for you to do so. You sit down in a chair, kind of like what you're doing for social media. You put your hand on a lever and the other hand kind of inserts coins and messes around with the user interface, like the buttons and all that fun stuff. And then you pull it down to see, you know, what could possibly come up. And this is another element of kind of the anticipation, because you see the numbers and, you know, icons floating all around you, but you don't know what's going to pop up. And so social media designers kind of use the same framework, as crazy as it may seem. They make it really easy for you to scroll through a newsfeed, because all you need to do is keep your hand there and your thumb is the only thing doing the work. So you can see there are a lot of similar nuances between, you know, really definitely habit-forming casino games and social media design. And you see the same thing too with swiping. This really came to light with Tinder and now Bumble, and a lot of dating apps kind of use this swiping mechanism, because it is super extremely easy to, you know, see someone you like and immediately dismiss them just based off of looks alone. This is an extremely, extremely popular design with dating apps, and we're gonna see it soon with e-commerce as well. So the next part of the hooked model is the investment. So after you take the action, what exactly is the investment part of this? So this is where the ask comes into play for the developer. A lot of the times it really comes down to money. So, you know, pay very close attention to the onboarding experience. So onboarding, you know, as soon as you download the app, it'll take you through a few sets of screens to introduce you to the app. And then of course they'll ask for your money straight off the bat. They'll put you through a free trial, put your card information, they're gonna charge you, and you're locked on already for, you know, months on end. And they make it very hard for you to cancel your subscriptions as well. It's very deliberate, they call a dark pattern in design. So a lot of the time, they're really after your money at the end of the day, but they also want, you know, your data, your time, the effort that you put in the app, your social capital, aka meaning your network of friends and family, and then purchases in the app. So this is in exchange for, you know, say a piece of clothing. And you know why they want it? Obviously, the more money, the better. So this is an example. This is a real example of an app developer's marketing dashboard. And here the overview of the main metrics that they're keeping an eye on. So impressions, so how many times is, or how frequently I should say, is the app showing up in App Store search results. Product page views, so how many people are actually tapping into the App Store listing and viewing the app itself. And then the conversion rate. So how many people that visit the product page itself actually convert to a download. And then from there, we also have, you know, the sessions per active device. This is usually calculated on a daily, weekly, or monthly basis. And then you have your monthly sales. And then you also have kind of the monthly average of, you know, how much the average user is spending in the app. And to wrap things up, I just want to touch on how to combat a bad phone habit if you do have one. There are a lot of tips and tricks you can implement. So the first one is probably the most important one, which is turning off all of your notifications. I run my own, again, marketing business, and I deal with apps, a ton of apps on the daily. So I can get, you know, anywhere from 20 to 50 notifications if I had all my notifications turned on. And there's a ton of research that backs up, you know, once your focus gets taken away from the main thing that you were actually doing, it takes 20 minutes for you to consciously regain that focus. So having notifications turned on for every single app is definitely a negative thing for you to do. So right after this workshop, I highly recommend you turn off majority of your notifications. It's probably the best thing you can do for yourself. Second biggest tip is putting your phone in a different room. Now, this isn't turning your phone off. This isn't putting it face down next to you. This is completely separating yourself physically from your phone. And there's a lot of research that backs this up too, but seeing your phone in person actually makes you dumber. I don't know exactly what goes on behind that, but it's definitely true. And this is kind of going into, again, staying focused at what exactly you're doing at hand. The third one you can do is contact the developers or leave a review on the App Store. I know not a lot of people do this, but the main thing that developers actually look at is the App Store rating and reviews, because it drastically has an impact on how and when they show up on the App Store. So if you want to get in and see a new feature change, you want to see a more productive way to do something, definitely leave a review on the App Store and be very in-depth as to how you came across, you know, wanting this new feature and the impact that it'll have on many other people aside from you. And I wouldn't be surprised that they would implement it if it is doing a positive thing, you know, for their users and for the app. The fourth one is downloading productivity apps and hiding the quote-unquote bad ones. Now, this is kind of counterintuitive in a way, but productivity apps are definitely super helpful if you have the right ones. So the one I use a lot is called the Pomodoro, I think it's Pomodoro timer. And basically what it does, it's a simple timer that goes off and has 20-minute intervals with 5-minute breaks in between. So this is extremely great if you're, you know, working from home, which everyone is, and you really want to focus in during, you know, the 5 to 8 hours you're working a day. So that's an example of a really great app. Other ones are, you know, Evernote to kind of keep track on what you're doing, any to-do list apps, or really anything that really isn't super bogged down in superfluous features that you don't necessarily need. And the final one is just simple as turning on grayscale. This is a funny one because not a lot of people know about this one. But the psychology behind this reasoning is that basically every single app is competing for your attention as far as colors go on the App Store homepage and in the App Store search results itself. So, you know, the more vivid, bright, appealing colors they use, the more likely you are to kind of tap into it again, whether or not you realize it in the first place. So turning on grayscale and getting rid of all of these, you know, bombardment of crazy colorful colors definitely limits usage in the phone itself because it becomes a lot less appealing and everything kind of looks the same. So you're really gonna only search out what you need in the first place. And again, going back to kind of like the push notifications too, all of the redness on your phone will be gone. So that's kind of a few high-level tactics that definitely work that everyone should implement, you know, right after this workshop. Everything that we've touched on today in the hooked model, there's the trigger, action, variable, reward, and investment. So the trigger, you know, what's the thing that's going to grab your attention to open up the app? Are you feeling hungry? You know, do you want to order Uber Eats? Do you actually really need to order Uber Eats, or did you actually not eat anything today and you really need it? Did you see a push notification from Amazon saying, hey, we're just checking in on you, when really they just want you to pop in the app and look at the new recommended for you page? So, you know, those are the triggers, the main thing that you need to be paying attention to every day to kind of nip a bad habit in the bud. The action, so, you know, what actions are you going to be doing in the app and for what reason? Are you using the app for leisure? Are you using the app to send an email? You know, you really have to be purpose-driven with technology. You know, you need to make it work for you and not the other way around, which is, you know, unfortunately a lot of the case. Then the reward, so, you know, what reward are you actually getting from this app? Is it superficial? You know, are you looking for validation with Instagram? Because that could definitely lead into a super bad habit. and it manifests itself in a ton of different ways? Or is it, you know, a good reward? For example, you know, if you just had a family event and you're looking forward to seeing all the picnic photos, social distance picnic photos that your family just posted, that's an awesome thing to look commenting and engaging on those photos with the family, and really, you know, cherishing those memories. So, you know, what's the reward that you're getting out of using the app? And then the investment. So what work are you doing for the developers in the first place? And do you really need to do that again? So paying attention to what piece of work you're doing to increase the likelihood of returning to the app. And this can be something as simple as posting a photo on Instagram, for example, or making another to-do list. But again, that those are good things. So you just really, at the end of the day, with the hooked model, you have to realize why you're using the apps that you're using. And really being cognizant of why you're using them and paying attention to how much time you're spending in the app itself. And the final kind of tip that I definitely want to leave everyone with is, you know, really going into your phone and analyzing which apps you're using, why you're using them, and looking at how much time you're actually spending on your phone itself. I know Apple, for a fact, does a really great job of weekly screen time, or how much time you're spending in the app on a given week and comparing it to the previous week. Not to say that, you know, all the time spent on your phone is bad, because, you know, again, it might not be, but it's just important to know how much time you're spending on your phone and where your time is being allocated to. So that's the workshop in a nutshell. I hope you guys, you know, really learned and got something out from this. And if you have any questions, you know, comments, concerns, I'm more than happy to answer any questions, whether it's right after this workshop or you guys want to just shoot me an email, a tweet, DM, I'm an open book and happy to answer any questions at all. Thanks, guys.
All right. Thank you so much, Carissa and Johnny. We are now going to answer some of the questions. First one that I have up here at the top is for Johnny. Is there an age requirement for Tecnologicas?
Well, we welcome anyone, any girls that are identified, or students that identify as girls in high school. However, there's a different process. If they are in high school and under 18, they would just need to send an email to tecnologicas@ncwit.org just to make sure that we're not, you know, that we don't encounter any issues, because it's a minor. But anyone 18 and over is welcome to sign up on our website.
All right, amazing. And we shared the link to that on in the chat, and we'll drop it again in there so you can connect with Tecnologicas and with Johnny. So what do you see as the biggest issue with schools allowing students to bring phones into the classroom? Do you see it as a good thing, a bad thing?
So I mean, it could be a mix of both for sure. Ultimately, it depends on what the use case of, you know, the phone is ultimately going to be, and permissions as well. I know a lot of schools lock down a lot of sites like YouTube, TikTok, thing when they can't download the app at all. It's only used for educational sites. So I would say that's, you know, it's a gray issue. But I mean, to address the root of the question, the biggest issue, I'm gonna throw it for like kind of a loop, but everyone always says like the biggest issue is like education, or, you know, scratch that initial thought. The biggest problem is focus. So, you know, lack of education. So using your phone to get information, or, you know, not going to college or the traditional route and going to YouTube to learn, you know, everything, like modern information on up and coming technologies. The lack of education is not an issue now, or nor will it be in the future. The real issue for especially bringing phones into the classroom and just using your internet in general, and this can apply to work from home as well. The real issue is going to be how well you can focus. You know, do you have 50 trillion tabs up? I mean, I have like 6 up right now. But there's so many different stats about, you know, if you get distracted from one thing, it's going to take you about 24 or 25 minutes to get back into the task you were originally doing. So once you're hopping back and forth from all these different things, you know, your attention has been like absolutely depleted and all over the place, and you did not do, you know, the one thing that you were supposed to do that day. So that's definitely the biggest issue I foresee with bringing phones into the classroom, is that, you know, it's great to have it in the classroom just because that's where we're all living now. But at the same time, you know, how well can your students actually focus? So that's why I recommend, you know, the social media blockers, or, you know, the time management systems.
Yeah, I know, like one of the big things that schools say is the, like, the kind of maintaining or the maintenance of students' mental health and whether or not they're on the social media while they're sitting in class, and how distracting that can be. So I definitely see the positives and the negatives to it.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So how about a question? It's a question geared towards Carissa, but for both of you. What are some roadblocks you've noticed along the way as you've started working in education, in tech, as you've moved forward in this, Johnny, you're in this encouragement piece with students. What are some of the roadblocks, and how are some of the ways that you've gotten over them?
So I would say that in the current role that I have, what I've seen as a roadblock specifically to Black and Brown students is that there is a lack of information and lack of access to what these opportunities are, where the resources exist, where people can go get them. Going back to the use of phones in the classroom as a former teacher, I would say that sometimes, depending on the grade level you're teaching to, it's a battle that you may or may not want to pick, but you can always incorporate the use of phones into your into your lessons to show students that there's an educational aspect to how they use and interact with their devices. So barriers, roadblocks, lack of information or access to that information, I would say.
Yeah, thank you. Carissa, what about you?
Yeah, most definitely. I answered this in the last panel, but the number one thing I get to address this question is that, yes, I do get, you know, questioned a lot because I am a lot younger. I actually started the work in marketing when I was 17, 18 years old. So, you know, going into a room of, you know, meetings with 30, 40, 50 something years old, there's always going to be that, oh, like, we've been here and done that. Like, why is she in this room? What value is she bringing to the table? So there's always that, you know, kind of bias in the back of a lot of people's heads. I've noticed, especially when they're, you know, they're in meetings with me. Like one meeting, for example, I vividly remember, I got into the meeting and the guy was very excited to work with me, but there was, he said one thing. He said, you know, how old are the people that you usually work with? Like, referring to my team members. I guess he was expecting me to say, you know, 40, 50, 30. So it's just like small things like that, that I catch in conversations where it's always like, okay, like, I understand that, you know, I may not have, as much experience as, you know, a 40, 50, 60 something that has an, you know, a huge background in media and came from, you know, Wieden and Kennedy as an agency. But I do bring all of these new thoughts, you know, experiences and value add to the table. So it's all about, you know, recognizing where you can optimize yourself in different situations.
Yeah, absolutely. Just kind of showcasing yourself as a professional, and I definitely understand. I did see one question that you had responded to, Carissa, already, but can you talk a little bit more about, you said that library is one of the number one underutilized resources. I think often people think that a library, why do we need to go see a physical book? Why do I need to go to an actual brick and mortar place? But tell me more about the usefulness of a library and what they have
Absolutely,
to offer.
For sure. It's so funny. I live and breathe by live and die by the statement that the library is the number one resource that we're underutilizing. I lived in my city's library from 17 to 21 years old in college. That saved me about $200 a month on a co-working space yearly. I got free testing resources. So instead of paying for a proctored exam, which would be maybe 50 to 100 bucks online, you could get it for free in the library. You have so many different books as opposed to going to Barnes and Nobles, which is great. But there are new releases in the library all the time where there's new information constantly being released. So you're saving, if you get like 3 books a month, that's like 60 bucks for just by going to the library. So, I mean, it's there's so many great resources within the library itself. I could go on and on, but it's all about, you know, going to your local library, seeing what's up with, you know, the tech scene, more or less, like the hackathons, learning how to code for older professionals. That's something I constantly see in a lot of libraries that way more people should be taking advantage of. But yeah, I mean, the one piece of advice that I would leave everyone with is just like Google your city's local library and see what they're offering.
Yeah, I would like to add to that, Kelsey, sorry, that this thought that libraries are these antiquated buildings is just wrong. So many libraries have maker spaces, 3D printers, you know, all sorts of different technologies that people can use and learn, you know, on a daily basis for free.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of librarians have all of the certifications or many of the certifications that computer science teachers might have. And they even have started to kind of switch the title to like a media specialist, where it is an underutilized resource that's being used. So thank you for addressing that. How about, let's switch to some of your journeys. What were some of the major pieces of encouragement that kind of got you to where you are? Or what would have been something that younger you wished you had as far as a role model or encouragement factor? If Carissa, would you like to start?
Yeah, I can start. So something that was great and instrumental in my journey was my family and my close friends, who were extremely supportive of, you know, whatever, you know, I chose to do, whether I answered this before, but my initial career goal was to be a classical guitarist and play, you know, in the Philippines and other third world countries and really bring, you know, that joy to, you know, third world countries. You know, I studied professionally for 10 years under, you know, co-ops, professional music instructors, you know, lessons, everything, you name it. So when it came time for me to switch to marketing, I felt like I needed to do something different. My parents invested so much time, money, and energy into music education along with me. So that was probably the biggest, you know, struggle that I needed to overcome, was just like not submitting to sunk cost fallacy, because they invested so much into me. But at the same time, they were extremely supportive that I wanted to go into marketing, because they saw like I had a very set plan as to, you know, I want to do this, this, and this, you know, social media marketing. This is where everyone is going. You know, the trend is this way, so I'm going to follow it, you know, not to say follow my heart, because that's just like super cliche. But they set me up on that path with, you know, resources, Photoshop classes, you name it. So I owe my parents everything in that sense.
That's great. Thank you, Carissa. Johnny, what about you?
I would add to that, that yes, definitely the encouragement piece from family members, but, you know, just to remind those of you who are on this call, is that we all have the ability to be influencers and change agents. So providing something as simple as encouragement, words of encouragement, they really do go a long way, and helping students really find the journey, find the pathway, and remembering that there isn't, you know, I think you mentioned this earlier, there isn't just one avenue into computer science. There's many different pathways that you can pursue. Carissa mentioned it in terms of like, you can be self-taught, you can go to community college, you can go the military route. There's so many different pathways into these careers, and just, you know, providing the encouragement again, for these students to really persist and pursue these fields is really, really key.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. And attendees, NCWIT has so many resources, especially on these pathways opportunities. So we don't have to be telling our students that college is the only option. These six-figure career fields and even more are there, and they're accessible through even community college, technical school, or online learning programs like Udemy that are free, Coursera, things like that. So we are able to encourage our students, no matter what the different backgrounds that they have, there are resources out there to assist them. Would there be anything else that Carissa or Johnny that you'd want to add before we end the session for the afternoon?
Right. I would say go check out all of our Technologica's video collection, get inspired, and start conversations on different career paths in technology by watching these videos with your students, with your family members, and yeah, that'd be it.
Absolutely. All right. Well, thank you both. Those are all the questions that we're going to take at this time. attendees, we would love to invite you to join us on April 21st as cyber.org and Samina Mundal, who created cyberweek.org, as they share with us about careers in cybersecurity. And cybersecurity is one of the fastest growing career fields in the nation, as well as in the world. And again, accessible through many different tracks of education. If you'd like to continue to receive updates from NCWIT C4C, you can fill out the link that we just put in the chat. You can also access our landing page. You can watch previous webinars that we've pre-recorded, or find out about the upcoming sessions that we have. And as we close out this webinar, a survey will pop up. We ask you to just go ahead and participate in that, and we hope to see you next month. Thank you. Bye.